honor and glory. Woo! Hallelujah. He's worthy of honor and glory. Amen.
Lift your hands to heaven. Father, we cover this service under the blood of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. We thank you for clean hands and a pure heart. God, we thank you for mercy over judgment. Forgive us for all our sins, God. How many of you need mercy over judgment? Father, we thank you for mercy tonight. Speak to us. Speak to those that are watching. Lord, Holy Spirit, have your way. We humble ourselves and we commit this service into your hands. Somebody say, in Jesus' name. Give somebody an elbow, high five. You may be seated, elbow, give them an elbow. Is the Lord good? Is he good? Tell somebody all the time. Let's go in our Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 4. It's great to have Jonathan Isaacs in the house. Y'all clap your hands for him. I hear Taquito already gave him a shout out. But isn't it great to have him? So I say amen. The Lord is good. Sometimes. All the time. That's right. 2 Kings chapter 4. If you will, go with me to 2 Kings, the 4th chapter. And those of you at home, we're going to give you time to get it in your Bibles. Go to 2 Kings chapter 4. We thank God for a word that is timely, in season, a word that will speak to us, a word that will change us. Faith cometh how? By hearing, that's right. And hearing comes how? By the word of the Lord. Let's go. The Bible says, now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets. There cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elijah. Who she cried unto? She cried unto Elijah, saying, thy servant, my husband is dead. She said to Elijah, thy servant, my husband is dead. And thou knowest that my husband, watch this. He said, my husband is dead, really. And thou knowest that my husband, I love this. So her husband was gone. She cried out to Elijah. I like the story. Follow me now. It's Tuesday night, so we could ask questions. If you have a question at home, you can ask a question. But the question has to pertain to what we're saying. Husband dead. She cried out to the man of God about a dead husband. Now, if you're home, you got to ask yourself some questions. Why is she crying out to the man of God and not to God? Why isn't she going to God personally? And why is she crying out to Elijah and saying that her husband is dead? The question you got to ask yourself is, what does Elijah have to do? The question, Bible study, what does Elijah have to do with a dead husband? It wasn't Elijah's fault that he was dead. So why would this woman who's alive cry out to Elijah about her dead husband? Again, it was not Elijah's fault that the husband was dead. Elijah was not the one that speaks life or brings death in the natural sense, but she cried out to him. And I want you to see her response. Watch what she said. She said, and thou knowest that my servant did fail you. Only Jonathan in the house. It never said fear you. He said, thou knowest that my husband or thy servant did fear who? Y'all could talk to me. Fear who? So what she's doing with Elijah is she's reminding Elijah that thy servant, he served you. And he was faithful in serving God. He was one of the prophets. And now he's gone. You know he feared God. Now, fearing God means, you know, he kept his commandments, God's commandments. He did the things he was supposed to do. He was a servant of God. He was faithful. And now that he's gone, me being his wife, there's a problem, Joey. There's an issue. There's something that's going on. And I want you to do something about what's going on. Let's read. Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord. And the creditors, now watch this, she gone from a dead husband, and she said, listen, and I ain't got no man to support my house. Husband gone, creditors are calling. So she was saying, I'm in financial crisis. She said, I got a financial situation going on, and I'm coming to you based on what my husband did. Notice what she said. She didn't come to him based on what she did. She came to him based on what her husband did. I love this. So she was using Shanda, her husband's life, as a reference. I love this. How many of you know that, the Holy Spirit just dropped down, load this, that sometimes when we go before God, the devil tries to make you and I feel like we're not worthy because of things that we may have done, things that we might have fallen short in. How many of you in this room ever fell short in an area you know that didn't please God? Whether you fell short and actually did it or even fell short in your thoughts, you fell short. But this woman was saying, I'm not coming based on what I did. I'm coming based on what my husband did, which is so key, Pastor Elliot, because that tells us that when we approach God, we don't approach God based on how wonderful we are, but we got to approach God on how wonderful he is. So when we go to God, Miss Carolyn, we have the legal right to say, God, I know I haven't done the things I should have done. I know I haven't said everything right. I know I didn't dot all my I's and cross all my T's, but I don't come on my strength. I come in the name of Jesus. Only one person heard that. So what you and I need to understand is what gives us liberty and freedom and boldness to approach God is not how wonderful we are, but how wonderful he is. So when you and I approach the throne of grace, we can't allow the enemy to condemn us and say, well, you can't approach God because of this, or you're not worthy to approach God because of that. Because Satan will always try to throw up something that you've done wrong. He will always try to bring up condemnation, or he will always try to bring up guilt. And how many of you, the devil ever tried to play with your thoughts on all the reasons why God didn't hear you or something's going wrong? Only one person. But this woman said, I'm not coming to you based on me. I'm coming to you based on my husband. Now take that analogy and say, Father, when we come and pray and say, God, I'm not coming to you because I've done everything right, but I'm coming to you in the name of Jesus. Somebody clap your hand and give God a praise right there. Because I might not have done everything right. I might not have been obedient in every area I should have been in, but I know who have done everything right. And Jesus paid the price for me. So God, I believe, first of all, that Jesus came. I believe that he died. I believe that he rose on the third day. So if I'm coming to you, God, I'm not coming to you based on my merits. I come in the name of? Somebody say the name strong. I come in the name of? So what gives you and I legal right to approach God based on the article, Stacy, I know you're watching and you're a lawyer, based on the article is using the reference and saying, listen, I know I didn't do right, but I ain't come in my name. I come in the name of the Lord. And because I come in the name of the Lord, that is what I put before you, God. I want you to hear me because I come in Jesus' name. I want you to hear me because I believe in the sacrifice of your son. I want you to hear me because I believe that his blood covers a multitude of sin. So God, I don't come on my strength. I don't come on my power. I don't come because I was perfect. I come in the name of Jesus. This woman said, I didn't come in my name. And watch this. It was her that had the problem, not her husband. Because what happened to her husband? He died. So it wasn't the husband that had the problem. It was her that had the problem. How many of you know it ain't Jesus that got the problem? It's us that got the problem. So when we come to God, we're not coming to God saying, God, I've done everything right. But we're coming and saying, okay, God, because I mess up, because I didn't say what I was supposed to say, because I wasn't obedient the way I was supposed to be obedient, I still come. I come because I recognize what Christ has done. That's what she's saying. I come because I recognize what my husband has done. And how many of you know, if she could go boldly, I hear you, God, because she had confidence in what how her husband was a servant, how many of you know we could go boldly before God because of what Christ has done? Somebody clap your hand and give God a praise. This woman didn't go with hesitation. She went with boldness. Somebody say boldness. She went with boldness. And the Bible tells us that we should approach the throne of grace with boldness. Let us come boldly. How could we come boldly knowing that we're unworthy? Because we don't come in our name. We come in Jesus' name. We don't come because we did everything right. We come in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And she told him what the need is. She said the creditor is calling. So when we approach God, we can't allow the enemy to play that game and tell us all of our unworthiness. Oh, this is so good. We can't let that devil play that game and make us feel at home. Well, we didn't dot all our I's and cross all our T's, so we can't approach God. God, we don't come in our name. We come in the name of? We come in the sacrifice of what Christ has done. And because he paid the price for me is why I came. So I came to legally claim what's mine. What was she claiming that was heard? She was saying, creditors are calling, and I need you right now to pay some bills. She was saying, I need to be debt free. She was saying, I got money issues. I so thank God, because some people we sometimes put God in a box. Those of you that are at home, and we think that we could only approach God about some things. How many of you know that everything that concerns us concerns the King? One person. Everything that concerns you, all the details of your life, your finances, or your children, your home, your marriage, your job, so even right down to physical things that go on in your body, everything that concerns you concerns God, and God is never too busy to answer. She went to Elijah, not to God, demand of God. That was a representation of God, and said, listen here, I got some issues, and the issues are my finances. The creditors are calling. Meaning she took what she was going through to God. Sometimes people say, I don't want to go to God with that because I feel like it's not big enough for God. Or I don't want to go to God with this because I feel like I'm not worthy. How many of you know you ain't got no time to play that unworthy game? Go before God and make your request known. Go before God and say, God, listen, I need a vehicle. God, listen, I'm concerned about my job. God, listen, something is breaking out of my body. I don't understand it. Don't ever let the enemy make you feel like you're not good enough to approach God. Approach God in spite of what's going on. This woman went to the closest thing that she knew that was close to God, and she said, Elijah, the creditors are calling. Not Elijah, I got a physical problem. Not Elijah, I need a spiritual need. She had a natural problem, and she needed God to answer a natural need. Meaning God's concerned about your light bill. God's concerned about your car payment. God's concerned about how you get back and forth to church, your vehicle situation. He's concerned about whether you got a job. He's concerned about every detail of your life. He's concerned about your hair. Is it growing fast enough? Is it falling out? God's concerned about your weight. Are you losing weight? Are you gaining weight? Everything that concerns you concerns God. Somebody clap your hand and give God a praise for that. And I love this. Elijah's response to the lady was, he said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Did she already say what the problem was? Or maybe I'm reading wrong. She turned to him and said, the creditors are calling. And then Elijah said to her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in thy house? So she was crying out to Elijah about a natural need, meaning Chanda. The creditors were calling. She's crying. So Elijah said, what can I do for you? What is in your house? So what Elijah did was he turned it back on her. A lot of times we look to blame people or circumstances or situations on what has happened or what is happening. Again, we look to blame situations, people, circumstances on what has happened. What did she say? You knew my husband feared the Lord and he is dead. But now Elijah didn't turn it on the dead. Elijah turned it on the living. He said, what do I have to do with thee? So Elijah was saying to her, the creditors are calling, but you have which is on the inside of you, what will help you get out of debt. He was saying, you have on the inside of you what's going to help bring you out of this situation. You have on the inside of you what will help you make yourself better. Sometimes, how many of you ever talk to yourself, had to encourage your own self and say, you know what, I got to make it out of this. Or I'm better than this. You had to have a talk. You had to sit your own self down and almost like shake yourself back to your center and say, look here, right now, I'm coming out of this. You had to fight your own self out of something. Has anybody in this room ever had to fight their own selves out of something? You had to have a talk with yourself. Say, you know better than this. And ain't nobody was around. And somebody saw you to be like, what's wrong with you? But you had to talk yourself up. You know better than this. So sometimes we got to find the strength within ourselves to tell us, I got this. We can't wait on other people to encourage us. Good preaching. We can't wait on other people to tell us we're coming out or we're going to make it over or we're better than that. Sometimes we got to tell our own self, look here, I got this. I'm making it out of this. I'm stronger than this. I'm going to stand through this. You got to have a talk with yourself and you got to remind yourself, I'm not weak. I am strong. The Bible says, let the weak say what? I am strong. Somebody say, I am strong. So why did he say, let the weak say that I am strong? He didn't say, let God say it. Sometimes you got to tell your own self, I am better than this. Sometimes you got to tell your own self, I am stronger than this. Sometimes you got to tell your own self, get up. What did I say? I went bohemian on y'all. What did I say? Have you ever laid in your bed? I don't know why this coming to me. Have you ever laid in your bed and you just wanted a couple more minutes? And you had to tell yourself, get up. But your body was saying, not now. And you had to tell yourself, get up. But your mind was saying, not now. So what was going on the inside of you and how you physically felt was completely in battle. Your body was completely fatigued, but you heard your mind saying, get up. And you might have lied there, but you kept saying, get up. And sooner or later, you pushed yourself up. Sooner or later, you found the strength to get up was because you had a talk with yourself. Some of you that are watching today, you got to have a talk over your mind. You got to tell your mind, look here, I know what God said. I believe what God said. I trust what God said. I'm going to make it out of this. Sometimes you're going to tell your mind, I am more than a conqueror. Sometimes you're going to tell your mind, I'm broke right now, but I'm not going to be broke all the way. Sometimes you're going to tell yourself, I'm better than the thing that I'm going through. You got to have a talk with yourself. Look at somebody and say, learn to talk to yourself. And the world will tell you if you talk to yourself, you're crazy. Look at somebody and say, ain't nothing crazy about that. You got to pull yourself out of what you're going through. Because we look for God to do it sometimes. But you got to look in your mirror. Sometimes some of you, in here you wait on people to compliment you. How many of you know you got to learn to compliment yourself? Say, I look good today. With nobody telling you you look good. Some of you got to look in the mirror and say, I'm handsome today. I'm handsome today. Speak to yourself. Speak life over yourself in the midst of tragedy. Clap your hand and give God a praise. Five of y'all, if you're at home, you could clap your hand. Did this woman have tragedy? Five of y'all, did she have tragedy? What was her tragedy? Her husband died. He was dead. But what did Elijah say? Elijah, yes, God, I hear you. He did not concentrate on you, poor thing. Oh, I'm so sorry to hear about your husband. He didn't approach her out of pity. Oh, it is so good. Because sometimes, you know why we tell people the negative thing first? Because we want somebody to feel sorry for us. You know, my husband did serve you, and she might have been looking for somebody to have a pity party. Maybe he can have sympathy on me because of what I'm going through. But Elijah didn't even talk about the husband. What Elijah said, what is your problem? What's in your house? Now, that could have offended her. Preach, black man. That could have offended us. Be like, I come to the prophet. I tell him about my husband. My husband was a man going to church. He was on the choir. He was faithful cleaning the church. He was building things. Joey, he was a faithful member. And look what he did. This man of God told me what's in my house. You know what? That's why I ain't going to church no more. What God wants us to do is not look for the outside. Find out what's on the inside of you. How could I pull myself out of this? What is it on inside of me that God has given me the ability to rise above what I'm going through? Am I concentrating on what's wrong or am I concentrating on what's right? I am so often around people who are saying, you know, I messed up here and I did this wrong. Yeah, you did some things wrong and you could dwell on that, but let's talk about what you did right. Yeah, you messed up in some areas, but there are areas that you did right. If there was nothing good about this woman, why would the prophet say to her, what is in your house? That means everything she needed to pull herself out was not in her dead husband. It was in her what was alive. Somebody tonight, you're concentrating on what's wrong. Somebody that's watching. You're concentrating on what's happening in the society. You're concentrating on what's happening in America. You're concentrating on everything that's wrong. But how many of you know that there's some good things that are happening? The good thing is that you're still alive. The good thing is that you still got breath in your body. The good thing is that you still got your limb. The good thing is you still operate. You're out of your bed and your belly is full. You can still have a mouth to give God glory. Somebody shout hallelujah right now just to make the devil mad. That ain't everybody. I say open your mouth and shout hallelujah. At home, you gotta find a reason to praise God in the midst of what's wrong. Find a reason to praise God in the midst of your circumstances. Not everything's right. She had a dead husband. First thing wrong. Creditors calling. Second thing wrong. And then I go to the man of God and he turned to me. What is going on? She could have begun to have a panic attack, but watch her response. after he turned it on her. Tonight, I know you're looking at people, everybody in the church wrong. I know everybody in the world's wrong. I know everybody in government's wrong. I know all of us wrong. But when will you stop blaming other people and turn the mirror on you? I know all of us, mama didn't do it right, daddy didn't do it right, children didn't do it right, the boss didn't do it right, the deacon didn't do it right, I know the pastor didn't do it right, but when will it stop being what everybody else has not done, and when will it come that you put the picture or the camera or the mirror on yourself and say, God, I'm not in this because of anybody else. Elijah said to the woman, what's in your house? You know, if somebody came to me right now, we live in a time, and they say, man, you see what's going on, and they struggling, and I was to say to them, what's in your house? You get so mad at me. Like, what's wrong with these preachers? They don't help nobody. All they're trying to do is help themselves. This woman did not take that posture. Watch her posture. With a dead husband, and you ain't had no dead husband or no dead wife, and then we have an attitude with God. That was not this woman's attitude. And Elijah said to her, I love it, first of all, she went on her husband's behalf. When we go to God, we should go to God on Jesus' behalf. God, I am not worthy, but I come in the name of. I wish somebody would hear me tonight. God, I know I don't do everything right, but I come in the name of. That is so key, because if you don't recognize who name you come in, the devil will keep you feeling condemned that you're not worthy enough to go. But I don't come in my, thank you for saying that. I don't come in my name. I come in the name of. So what you're doing is saying, God, I know I'm supposed to be here, but let me show you my card. My card is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. This is what gives me access. That's the key. What's the key? Jesus is the key. And when you understand that, no one could stop you from coming in. This woman went not on her own. She went on behalf of her husband who feared the Lord. So she didn't say, I'm coming to Elijah to you based on me. She said, I'm coming to you based on my husband. Now turn that to God. God, I don't come to you based on me. I come to you based in the name of Jesus. No argument. Let's go. Elijah said to her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what dost thou have in thy house? She went in for the creditors and he asked her, what you have to do in my house? That's fighting words. And she said, thy handmaiden has not anything. What'd she say? I ain't got nothing in my house. I ain't got nothing in my house. I love this. Save a pot of oil. She said, I ain't got nothing in my house except a little oil. Oil. Oil, J.U.M.P. Oil, Sunday message. Holy Spirit just said that. Oil, J.U.M.P. He's speaking to us about oil. Oil, J.U.M.P. He's speaking to us. Those who are watching by TV, he's speaking about oil. Oil again. She said, I have nothing in my house. Remember, there was not except a little bit of oil. She said, I have nothing. God is trying to tell us in this hour, we got to make sure that there's oil in our lamps. That's the second time. I was coming from, the Holy Spirit just reminded me, he said, the Holy Spirit just downloaded. He said, Tuesday, he said, Sunday, you spoke about oil. Now tonight, he says, she have nothing but a little bit of oil. The Lord is letting us know that the way that we're going to make it out of debt financial crisis is by listening to the instructions and being led by God. The way we can make it out of depression is being led by God. Not blaming other people, not blaming our neighbors, not blaming the things that are happening in our country. We have to look to God. Who did this woman look to in the time of crisis? She looked to God. God is trying to get us to look to him in a time of crisis. And I hear you, God. And when she looked to the man of God, who did the man of God make her look to? Herself. Somebody say, Jesus. I thank you for being here. He made her look for us to herself. Because what was he trying to say to her? He was saying, you have what you need on the inside of you. How do you know she had what she need? Because she, let me tell you how. Let me tell you what the Holy Spirit just downloaded. Let me tell you how. First of all, she had the mind, Shanda, for, if you hear me, this will change your life. She had the mind to know her husband feared the Lord. Don't just say yes. What does that mean? That means she lived in the same household and she saw her husband's example. So that means she gleaned from what her husband had. So God was saying, even though your husband is dead, lady, I need to know there's some things in you that are not dead. There's some things that you learned from him when you were alive. And now it's time for you to put those things to practice. And she said, I ain't got nothing but a little bit of oil. You know, the enemy will always show you what you don't have. Oh, this is so good. Rather than what you have. Notice what she said. I ain't got nothing but a little bit of oil. I ain't got nothing. That's how she said. Why did she say, I got some oil, but I don't know how this can work. She said, I ain't got nothing. So that means, she said, how can this oil work for me? Oh, Shani, you heard that. How can what I have work for me? What we need to understand is, as long as God is in the vessel, as long as God is first in our life, whatever we have can work for us. Somebody clap your hand and give God a praise. Oh, Shanda, I wish I had an apple. I'm seeing an apple. Whatever you have in your hand, God is saying to you, whatever you have, you got to learn to use. It ain't what you don't have. It's what you have. It ain't what you've lost, it's what you've gained. So I'm looking at the people that I hear you. So many times they'll be like, you know, my sister here no more, my brother here no more. You know, my close friends ain't with me no more. And the people who in your life be like, Lord, what am I? You're crying over everybody that walked out. What about the people who are still in? You're crying about everybody that is not there. What are the people who are in your life supposed to do? So you're crying about everybody that walked, but what about the people that stayed? How do you celebrate them? What about the people after people have walked out? What about the people that God has allowed to walk in? And if anyone in this room tell the truth, people might have walked out of your life, but every time they walk out, somebody else, God allows somebody else to walk in. And sometimes they are better than the ones that walked out. Oh, clap your hand if you hear me tonight, man. Clap your hand in the room, jump. Don't worry about nobody around it. Let us apply to you. Somebody say, I still got something in my house. Say it strong. Say, there's something still in my house. Thank you, sir. I hear you. So she said, I have nothing but a little bit of oil, pot of oil. Then he said, all he needed was her confession. I love, remember I said, say. All he needed, Chris, was her confession. Remember I say sometimes you got to call yourself out of it? All he needed for her to recognize was, lady, you got something. All he needed was for her to see something good. That's why you got to see what's right in your life rather than what's wrong. Say why? Because it was the little bit that he caused her to use. Suppose she had said, I ain't got nothing. He was trying to say, it's by your confession you have what you need to get out. Okay, who said yes? What was her confession? I have a little bit of oil. And watch how the story goes. He never said, the story never talked about what she didn't have. It only talked about what she had. Then he said, go borrow. After her confession, she got the command. Your blessing is tied up in everything you say. So when you start saying, I can't make it, I don't know if I can make it, I don't know if I can make it out of this, I don't know if I can come back, I don't know if I can get married, I don't know if I can get a new car, I don't know if I can get the job, I don't know if they can hire me, I don't know how long I can live here, I don't know how long I can be in this church, you're already setting up your future. Whoever said, wow, heard me. You set it up by what you said. You set it up by your negativity. You could set up your success by what you confess. Oh, that was good. That's a rap. That's a rap taquito. You could set up your success by what you confess. Look at somebody and say, start confessing right. Okay, 3 years. You could set up your success by what you confess. What are you confessing when things look dead? How are you still moving? He only operated out of what came out of her mouth. I've never saw that before. I'll say it again. She said, I have nothing in my house except a little bit of oil, Shanda. Then he gave her the command. So he needed her, Pastor Elliot, to see what she had. What God needs America to do is to see what they have. How many of you know God is still in America? Only Pastor Elliot. How many of you know God is still for America? If God was not for America, how many of you know we would be dead and gone a long time ago? You know, sometimes we forget how big God is. How many of you know if God was done with us, God could just blow a wind and we could be gone? He could just, and we could be gone. God, somebody say, God is still with me. In spite of the death. Oh, that's good. Did she have death? What did she lose? Say, God is still with me. In spite of the death. But God can only use, see, God is in the faith realm, y'all. Not that he's not with us in the natural, but everything that comes from heaven must come by faith. So God can only operate by the confession of your mouth. So when Elijah, Joey, was asking her what was in your house, what he was trying to do was trigger faith. Say, prove it. How was he trying to trigger faith? By asking her. A lot of times what we're going through, the reason why God is trying to get us to go through it is not because he's trying to kill us or get us depressed. He's trying to trigger faith. How do we know he's trying to trigger faith? By our response to what we're going through. The test is what triggers the faith. So when you start go drawing back, when you start saying, I ain't gonna do this no more, I ain't gonna go no more, I ain't gonna trust nobody no more, God said, I can't download your blessing. Because your blessing can only come by based on your response. It's not heaven that's wrong. And it ain't heaven that's holding up our blessing. Guess who's holding up our blessing? It's us. God is perfect in all his ways, but what's hindering God from moving in our lives has nothing to do with God. It has everything to do with us. How, Shanda? By what we're confessing. Let me ask you a question, Joey. Was this woman going through something? Anybody? One. Was she going through something? What was she going through? The death of her husband. What else? Financial crisis, correct? So was she going through something? Is America going through something? Is America going through something? But who did this woman turn to when she was going through something? She turned to the man dove. Who we turn into when we go through things? Okay, let me put that down. Miss Carolyn, we know you turn to God. But on the average, who is America turning to answer that? So because man is not turned, and listen, when you turn to bitterness or you turn to anger, or you turn to frustration, or you turn to, I ain't gonna be around nobody no more. Can God respond to that? Why? No, something else. Why can he not respond to it? Because you're not practicing faith. God can only respond to faith. Listen, I wanna say this, and please, this is Bible study, you can ask questions. What you can do? So don't let me just say things and you don't act. Because I'm bishop, you just say, hear what I'm saying. God is bound by something. He's bound by his word. Very good. Not just he's bound by his word. He also has to operate in the realm of his word. That means there's nothing he can do on the planet without faith. Say, prove it. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. So anything that is done from heaven must be done how? By faith. But that almost sounds unfair. I hear you, Holy Spirit. But God will set up situation to cause the faith to come out of us. That's very good, Takeda. Let me show you why. But what most people do is they look at the situation and they get angry rather than saying, God, what are you trying to bring out of me? So they get angry, they get frustrated, they get bitter, they leave, they get mad, they hold a grudge, and God is saying, I can't give you what you want because you haven't operated in the realm that causes me to release it. I'm coming. Just hold it. Just write it down. I promise you I'm coming. So if you operate in the realm that will cause you to release it, then God can deposit it. He cannot deposit anything in his natural realm without faith. Say, prove it. He that cometh to God, Shanda, must first do what? No, you're just quoting. He must first believe. So watch what he said. He that cometh to God must first. So that means the first thing you got to do before you come is what? So you can't come without belief. So I tell you, the first criteria in knowing God or coming to God is belief. Belief has everything to do with faith. So if you're not operating in the faith realm, how could you get anything from God? How can God release everything? So every test you went through, every trial you went through, every death you lost, everything that happened with COVID-19, and people had to lose loved ones and lose jobs in the economy. God is saying, I know everything you went through, and you did serve me, husband did fear the Lord, but it's not what you're going through, it's what I'm trying to bring out of you. Say, prove it. It wasn't until she had tragedy that she had to look within herself. How many of you know tragedy will make you better or it'll make you bitter? I wish I had somebody real. Tragedy will make you blame. It'll make you drop out the race, or it'll bring faith out of you. Most people don't rise to tragedy. Most people shrink back to tragedy. They get depressed. Why did it happen to me? What I did wrong? I'm right on it. Y'all may think I'm not on it. Why did this happen to me? Why was what I did wrong in my life? God, why did you do it? And God said, I didn't do this because you did something wrong in your life. I'm doing this to show you what's still the power that you have in you. Did you get that? Very good. So don't look. So tonight, what we have to learn to do, Jacob, is we have to change our perspective. A lot of us look at trials and tests like, man, I don't want to go through it. But how will you know what's in you if you don't go through it? So you'll never know what resides in you until a test comes. She never discovered her oil was valuable until her husband died. Or she would have just had the oil in the house. I'm preaching. You don't know how strong you are until somebody close to you is gone. Then you recognize what's strong in you. You recognize the entrepreneur in you. You understand the baker in you. You understand the millionaire in you. But in order for you to understand the millionaire in you, you had to go through some broke days. For you to become an independent business owner, you had to get fired. But if you didn't get fired, you'd have been making $20 an hour. But that getting fired took you from $20 to $100 an hour because the entrepreneur in you had to rise. But if you didn't rise through tragedy, you would have stayed on somebody's job. So God had to put your back against the wall so you could discover the business person on the inside of you. So you cried, oh, somebody clapping in the room. That's right, child. So you crying over getting fired. But if you cry over we're getting fired, then how will you find the entrepreneur in you? I hear you, God. You know why a lot of people can't find success, those at home and those that are watching tonight? The reason why you can't find success is because you're so busy crying over what you've lost that you can't see what you got to gain. What is in your house? She said, I ain't got nothing but a little bit. Watch, I ain't got nothing but a little bit of oil. Then Elijah said, you know what? I just needed you to see that you had something. I wish I had a penny. Somebody, I wish I had a penny. I wish I had a penny. I wish I had a penny. Just a penny. Just a penny. I wish I had a penny. Just a penny. I wish I had a penny. I wish I had a penny. Just a penny. I wish I had a penny. Just a penny. Somebody got to have a penny in here. I thank you, ma'am. Watch this. All God needs is a penny. See, you got that. All God needs is a little bit. If she had said, I ain't got nothing, then God would have had nothing to respond off. When you got that? When she said, I have a little, God said, oh. That made God do a little step. God said, I got it. So she said, I ain't got nothing but a little bit. So what God is saying, I don't need you to have great faith. I just need you to have just a little bit of faith. I don't need you to have a big belief. Just believe just a little bit. Tell somebody, says, just a little bit of belief. Say, all you need is just a little bit. Watch this. Then he said to her, watch this. It wasn't until she said, I ain't got a little bit of oil. Then he gave her the command. He said, go borrow from all your neighbors as much bottles as you can find. Watch this. He didn't tell her, tell your neighbors to bring you the bottles. He said, so in other words, he still made her work in midst of her pain. She had to make it very good, Takia. She had to make it happen. You know what else, too, that she had to make it happen? A lot of times when you operate in what you're called to do, it takes your mind off of your tragedy. Because you're busy functioning in ministry. A lot of people still crying over what they lost because they're not operating in ministry. He put her to work. I need to concentrate on living and not dying. You see that, Pastor Elliot? You're waking now. How I need you to concentrate on living. Go borrow some bottles. Go find, and watch this channel, go find as many bottles as you can. And she went out and she found as many bottles as she could. She went out, and after she found as many bottles as she could, he said, now pour the oil. How could you find a little bit of oil, go borrow all bottles from all your neighbors, and expect all those bottles to be filled? That's not your concern, that's God's concern. See, a lot of us wonder how the business can function, how I can pay for this building, how I can pay for this car, how I can pay for this, how I can get married, how I can do these things, and I don't have everything to part. If you do obedient to do what God told you to do, that ain't your responsibility. That's God's responsibility. This is so good. Say, prove it. She just went crying out. It was the man of God that said, go borrow the bottle. So after, all she had to do was be obedient. It wasn't a concern for the bottles to get filled. It wasn't a concern to be worrying about the bottle. All she was doing was operating under the obedience, and it was God's responsibility to fill the bottles. You need to know it's God's responsibility to take care of you when he tells you to go somewhere. That's some good stuff. If you put me in the sport, God, is your responsibility to keep me. If you put me in the marriage, God, is your responsibility to keep this marriage. God, if you made me a mother, you made me a father, it's your responsibility to keep this home. God, if you gave me this business, it's your responsibility to keep this business. Because I was minding my own business. I came to you, I told you I got a little bit of oil, and you told me to go borrow the bottles. I would have just kept my little bit. So watch this. When she went and borrowed the bottles, now watch God. See, you and I need to know, God will always do the extra because faith must respond to your obedience. What we need to do is, faith demands a response. I always tell people this, you cannot operate in faith and fail. Say, prove it. You remember the boy who said he was in a bad car accident? How many of you remember that Sunday? Thank you for being here. You remember how he said he couldn't move? His body was aching, he could not move. He said he tried to scream, he couldn't talk. Body back was broken, three surgeries on the back. He said nothing. He said he kept forcing himself to move. Remember he said that? How many of you know he was operating in the realm of faith? And now he can talk, he can walk. He said there's nothing that none of us, he said he could outrun us. He said, there's nothing that we can do that he cannot do. Because faith demanded his body to act right. Oh, you only hear that. He was screaming and didn't hear himself, but he said, I'm not staying in this bed. And the thing I like about that boy's story, I don't know why he isn't back here. We need to have a talk with LaShonda. I don't know why isn't that boy here, because he's supposed to be in jump. He brought pictures to prove that he wasn't lying. Because, you know, a lot of times people say, it was an accident. Yeah, right. He wanted us to see how bad that accident was, to show the testament of what faith can do. So it wasn't his body. The doctor said heal him. It was faith that brought him out of that bed. Say the power of faith. All he needed to believe was that he could talk. Is he talking? All he needed to do was believe that he could walk. Was he walking? He was walking and sharing his testimony. Why? It was because he believed. All God needs from you and I tonight is not how wonderful we are, how great we are, how perfect things is. God is saying, just give me a little bit and trust me and I'll work everything else out. Just make one step and I'll make up the all nine for you. Say amen. Amen. Clap your hands and give God a praise. I always say this, I'm about to go. Y'all can ask questions. I always say this, and people don't believe it, but I always say this, and I'll say it until Jesus returned to the planet. Faith is the greatest commodity on the planet, not money. You can spend money, but you can't spend faith. Faith is eternal. I want to say this. A lot of people strive to get money, but you shouldn't strive to get money. You should strive to get faith. Say, what's the difference? The faith will produce the money. But people in that back room going off in there. A lot of people, they don't operate in the faith realm because they, for them, seeing is believing. So they got to see it before they believe. But in God, God is saying, you got to believe before you see. What is that called? It's called faith. Tonight, y'all, we don't win because what we don't have. We win because we believe. Oh, Shanda, that's... Would we believe, Odis? We believe that he could do something with a little bit. How do we know we believe we could do something with a little bit? Because she responded to his command. Okay, let me ask you a question. I know you all like to ask me. How would you know she didn't believe? Take your time. Don't just off the cuff. How would you know if she did not believe? If she didn't respond to the command. I'll say it again. You would know she didn't believe if she didn't respond to his command, even though she had what she needed to get out of it. You know what that means, Miss Carolyn? A lot of people have what it takes to get out, but they don't believe because they think what they have in their hand is too little for God, but they don't know, they don't need what's in their hand. They need what's in God's hand. What does God need? I know, but there's a word I want you to hear, not just a little bit. Bring that into 2020. What does... No. Those things are right. What does he need from you beyond your belief? Not just your confession. Your response. Walk with me. He needs your, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe. I believe, I believe, I believe. Go get me some bottles. How demonstrated in her response was a demonstration that she believed. How do you know? Because the creditors were still calling. The little bit of oil was still there. You making me work for what I need to get done, and it ain't happening. I got an immediate need. What was the immediate need? Give me what I need. Let me go pay the creditors. He made her work before he filled the bottles. Her response to what he said is how you know she believed. That's why if you could come to church for 30 years, you could watch TV for 50 years, you could read your Bible all day. It ain't what you read, it's your response to what you read. I hear you, God. God said it's not even just your confession. Your confession is the beginning. Because she confessed, I had oil. It's her response as a command after she had to go borrow all the bottles. Then take the oil and pour it in. When she took the oil and poured the oil in the bottles, then and all the bottles were filled. Then he said, if I'm in the book, read the book, Shanda. Then he said, go sell all the bottles of oil. And after you sell all the bottles, he said, go pay the creditors. She became a saleswoman from tragedy. So good. So good, Takeda. Powerful. Watch this. Guess when the oil ran out? When she stopped bringing the bottles. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe if she had brought bottles straight into 2020, God would have still filled them bottles? 100% yes. Because Elijah is a... That's why you must believe you could be as great as you want to be. I know I pointed at him, but you know what all of us should be doing? So your greatness isn't predicated on around you who's great. You're as great as you want to be. Okay, you go as far as you want to go. I went as far as my body could take me. This is all I could do. I'm so wrong. I can't do no more. I'm done. I got no more strength. I went as far as I could go. Liar, liar, drawers on fire. You went as far as you wanted to go. Because it only stops when you stop. Which is so powerful, Pastor Elliot. Which Miss Carolyn, Pastor Elliot, age has nothing to do with. My life is over. I don't reach it now. Let them young people live their life. Life over because you ended. It ain't for me no more. My life is over. Let these young people have their fun. When did God say this was young people world? So your life ain't end because of God. It ended because you turned 50, you turned 60, you turned 70. Donald Trump, we cover him under the blood of Jesus. He's in his 70s, almost his 80s. He's the president of the United States. And he's running for another election. His life ain't ended. So what makes you and I think that our life is over? Why do we quit? Matter of fact, Joe Biden, how old is Joe Biden? Isn't he in his 70s? He's in his 70s, and he running for what? So when was the last time you run for mayor or city commission at a certain... We get at a certain place in life and think life is over. It over because you stop. God ain't never stop. You stop believing beyond good. You stop trusting God. You came to a place where you said it was enough, when God said it only stopped when you stopped. Age does not matter in God. Well, thank you, Takia. I'm going to say it again. Age does not matter in God. What I said? Age does not matter in God. It was my 7-year-old son that just had a dream about chips. God showed him a prophetic dream at 7. I'm the prophet. I'm the prophet. What are you doing, your child? I'm the prophet of the house. He skipped me. Me and God have never talked with that ODs. I just skipped the prophet of the house and go to a 7-year-old child. Again, age does not matter in God. In other words, he's no respecter of person. You stop living because of you, not because of God. You stop receiving wealth because of you, not because of God. You stop dreaming because of you, not because of God. You stop striving because of you, not because of people. Can I say a little bit more? You stop maturing because of you and not the color of your skin. How many of you know if God be for you? Is that true? If God be for you, your color could be against you. Yes, that's what it is. Yes. He said, if God be for you, tell me who. Somebody say, God got me. It was you that stopped you. As long as you believe that anything's possible in God and you follow the instructions in God, which sounds so simple, but it isn't, you know. It sounds so simple, Chandler, but it really isn't. Say, why is it? Is it? Because most people can't believe in tragedy. Most people could believe in success. Say how? She wasn't calling Elijah when her husband was alive. She was cool. She got desperate when her husband was dead, only for God to show her what was in her. Say this, say all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. So even the negativity, God will work together for the good. Let me ask you a question. Did God work it together for her good with a dead husband? Only one person. Take your time. Let me ask it again. Did God work it together for her good, even though she had a dead husband? How did he do it? By filling her boils, showing her what was in her, and showing her what a little bit could do. Y'all want some more? She went from owing the creditors to having money left over. Oh, Taki is so with me. She had the overflow from owing. What brought the overflow? Her faith. Her faith. Wait. Money brought it. Her faith brought the overflow. It's your faith that brings success. Not who I know. Not, that's where the world miss. The world think, I got to get close to this person. I got to get to another person. I can't make it except I know this person. They ain't going to hire me except I got this degree. And how many of you know degrees are good? But how many of you know God could open doors that degrees can't? Turn the cameras off. This is only for us here. Turn the cameras off.
J.U.M.P. Ministries Global Church Community Outreach Program presents the Global Food Festival. It's community outreach with global impact. Taste the world with food from over 10 different nations. It's a multicultural experience in your backyard. Become a part today. Always free for the community with VIP giveaways.
Here, J.U.M.P. Ministries Global Church, our Global Food Fest, we have just witnessed the winner of a brand new car, and she is right here, and she's excited.
Okay, about 6 months ago, my car put me down, but I was pressing my way on. I said, God gonna bless me with another one, but I just didn't know when. But today is my day. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, hallelujah.
And she pressed her way here. She got on a church bus, I heard, and she pressed her way here. God knows. Her faith was activated today, and it just came to pass in Jesus' name. So we thank you guys so much for being here, and congratulations again. That's a powerful testimony. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here.
This is a social experiment with world-class results. It's pure family fun, featuring the very best in ministry and various arts and artists.
Information and events. You're watching The Daily 2.
Hi, I'm Meg Clemente, and you're watching The Daily 2. A global pandemic isn't stopping Florida Technical College from providing essential supplies and resources to students in need. FTC just held a virtual back-to-school supply drive and partnered with multiple community partners, including the Orlando Magic, to ensure that students in need would have access to supplies. Here to tell us more is the president of Florida Technical College, Dr. James Burkett. Can you tell us more about this back-to-school supply drive and how long FTC has been organizing this event?
It's one that Florida Technical College has been involved in for almost a decade. It's extremely important to us, a part of our larger initiative under FTC Cares. And just the backpacks themselves that each contained a group of school supplies, over 2,500 just from Florida Technical College, and then at least another 1,000 from those partner organizations who decided to match some of the Florida Technical College donation.
This is amazing stuff. And FTC actually partnered with the Orlando Magic this year. Can you tell us more about that?
One of our initiatives with the Orlando Magic is partnering with them and an organization that Jonathan Isaac from the Magic has really championed, which is Project Life. So Project Life is involved in helping a lot of people in Central Florida. Throughout the pandemic, they were instrumental in providing meals to children and families. And this now allows them to expand that offering and provide school supplies for those in need as well. I think it's so important for me because, you know, we're part of the community. Definitely everything that's good for the community is good for all of us. And I think we have to take more of a holistic approach and help those that need it most.
Dr. Burkett, thank you so much for your time. To learn more information about this great initiative and on how to enroll,
visit magic.ftccollege.edu.
Till next time, I'm Megan Clemente with The Daily 2.
Something for those who thought we lost their ears. Jam, street reggae. I won't be down anymore. I won't be bound anymore. I won't be sad anymore. I won't be had anymore. I won't be told anymore. Yeah. Bang down, gotta stay on the floor. Yeah. Cause the floor ain't a place for winners. Yeah. Staying down ain't the thing for believers. I'ma be the one still moving. And you'll be the one moving. I hope you ain't wishing nothing bad on me. Cause you got some weird anointing bad on me. I'ma be the one still holding my hands. And you gon' be the one still trying to understand. Why the Lord keeps on blessing me? Why the Lord keeps being good to me?
Don't really tell me no.
I'ma do it.
Even when they say it ain't so.
I'ma do it.
Even if they laugh at me.
I'ma do it.
Even if they pass by me.
For my unbelief in the time of trouble. Everybody in here, you know when we, you know how we get when the money ain't right. You know how we get when the children ain't right, when the knee ain't right, when the family ain't right, when things ain't right. You know how we roll. But we don't get good news. Everyone in here, when we get, we know how we roll when them creditors call it. Like, what? I paid my tithes. You know how we roll when we get fired? That's, I ain't gonna see you for about a week. You depressed. You know how we roll, Denise, when our leg get, when fire, when we get burned on our feet? Now we roll. What we do wrong? I came tonight to you. You didn't do nothing wrong. He's trying to pull something out of you. He's trying to pull a little bit out of you because it's all he needs. Father, we humble ourselves again and we repent. We repent for our unbelief. We repent for doubting you. Somebody say, God, you are awesome. If you mean that, stand on your feet. Jonathan, you ain't got to stand. You ain't got to try to stand. Keep your leg in the chair. Say it again. Say, God, you are awesome. If you mean that, lift your hands. Tell him, eyes closed. Lift your hands high. Say, God, you are wonderful. Is he really? I mean, for real, for real. Is God wonderful? He is, man. He is. He really. That's right, Miss Carolyn. Hallelujah. Lord, you are so wonderful. Y'all, even if you didn't think he's wonderful, just how he kept you COVID-free. None of us in this room have COVID-19. Y'all should have said, in the name of Jesus. I hear some of y'all say, not yet. I am confessing that. I say, none of us in this room got COVID-19. Y'all should be around my wife. My wife, everybody in here need to be around Lady Hepburn. Lady Hepburn, she's so done with COVID-19. When I say that, she mean COVID-19 is not coming to her. She mean that. Fong has made up her mind, I ain't getting sick. She'd be like, honey, maybe you, but not me. She has just left this world when it comes to COVID-19. She said, ain't nothing going up my nose. She has made up her mind she's not getting sick, and she's operating that, boy, and thank God for her faith, amen. I meant to say something else, but I pull it back. Father, we thank you. Thank you for faith, Rem. Thank you for living by faith. Thank you for making JU.M.P a church of faith. If you believe that, take a step forward. We are. We should call ourselves JU.M.P Faith Ministries. Yes, we should. JU.M.P Faith Ministry. Because everything we do is by faith. I think if one thing Jonathan Isaacs has learned becoming here is he's learned faith. We refuse to let him stay where he is. He's pushed and pushed. That's because he's around faith. Oh, y'all. It's not just you know, it's who you're around. She had to get in agreement. She had to get to someone who had faith. She had to get to Elijah, and Elijah told her what to do. Stop thinking you don't need nobody. Stop thinking, I need nobody, I got this. You better stop that. Everybody needs somebody. But you need to write somebody. That's right. Hold the mic. Somebody say, I need to write somebody. Yes, you need to write somebody. Because you know what that means? There is a wrong somebody. If there's a right one, there must be a wrong one. Somebody say, I want to write somebody. There's somebody that I can go to in the midst of tragedy. Oh, eyes closed. Who do you go to in the midst of your tragedy? And I hear somebody say, I don't go to no one. Besides Jesus, y'all, it gotta be more than Jesus. She didn't go to God. Who she went to? Elijah. You gotta have somebody in your life that can agree with you, that believes in the midst of your tragedy you can make it out. Oh, JU.M.P. Father, I cover this room under the blood. God, tonight I ask and make a request. Let this word find good ground from the pulpit to the door. You know why it tastes good to me? Because I need it to. My faith isn't to the place where it has arrived. Get out of here. There's so much room for it to grow. So this isn't just taste good to you. It tasted good to me because he's still stretching me. And as long as I live, he will stretch me. And let me say this to you. I believe this. This is me. This is not in the Bible. But I believe throughout eternity, we will be growing in faith. I don't even believe when we die and go to heaven, I don't believe our faith stops. I believe we'll forever be growing in faith, because I don't believe that there's an end to faith. I believe faith is eternal. I say, how could you believe that? Because God is eternal. There's no end to faith. So even when you think you've catapulted, God's saying, room for more. When you think I've arrived, God's saying, room for more. Psych. God has been psyching us. Psych. Even when you think you've catapulted faith, he stretches you more. If you don't believe me, ask Jonathan. 3 times. Even when he thought, God say, I got something, I go, psych. There's nothing that could happen in the earth that God don't give permission. Satan can't, he's on a leash. He cannot do nothing that God don't allow. Somebody say, amen. That should have been, and it is so. Satan does not surprise God. How can you surprise Alpha and Omega? Father, tonight I cover every heart, hands raised, every mind, every soul in this room. God, tonight we appreciate the psych. So is it God? I appreciate the psych. So help me to learn from it. Say, help me to get better from the psych. Help me not to blame you. Help me not to get bitter at you. But help me to learn from the psych. He's not trying to hurt you, y'all. He ain't trying to play tricks. He's just trying to show you what's in you. Not just the bad, but the good. Not just the bad, but the good. That was so good. Not just the bad. You ain't all bad. I know they try to make it like that, but you're not all bad. I know the devil will try to tell you that, but you ain't all bad. You're really not. There's some good. Every person in this room tonight, I know you got some issues, but there's some good in you. Because if there were not, you wouldn't be in this room. You, cool you, lover boy you on a Tuesday night. Fix your hair. You know how you roll after you get a nice haircut and your hair a little flat, and you get them little, that barber make them little tight, them haircut nice and that razor. Cool you in church on a Tuesday. There's some good in you. In spite of how the devil tries to show you the all bad, there's some good in you. Tonight I choose to concentrate on the good. I want you to concentrate on the good. Look at you in church on Tuesday. That's good. You? Short temper you, smoking weed you, come on. There's some good. Hand raised. Father, I pray you open our eyes to see the good. Not just personally, but those who are close to us. They see the good. Not just the bad, but the good. Somebody say, Lord, say, only if you mean it. Say, help me to see the good. Only if you mean it. Say it again. Say, Lord Jesus, help me to see the good. That's so key, y'all. Not just the good in ourselves, you know, the good in others. Not just the good in ourselves, the good in others. Not always the bad. See the good. It's the devil that is the accuser of the brethren, not God. The Bible says Satan, that's right, Shadrach, is the accuser of the brethren. Didn't say God was. Shouldn't be accusing each other, man. It's Satan that does that. Hand raised. As your hands raised, I want every heart in this room to get ready to sow. You're on good ground. You're on good ground. Because your faith was renewed, you see. You saw what a little bit can do. See, people here tonight, people in the world tonight, they don't know what a little bit could do. People think in the world that they are at their worst when they are at their best. That's right, sir. People in the world don't understand that in God there is no failure. Because they're not hearing this tonight. They're hearing a different message. And that's why it's so key in troublesome times what message you hear. Especially when you are really dealing with death. Especially when you are already dealing with tragedy. The wrong message could set you off because you're already dealing with something underlying. It's like someone adding fuel to the fire because you're already dealing with something underlying. Lord, tonight, open every ears, including mine. No one is exempt from this word. God, I hear you. How little is much with you. And we repent for thinking we need much when we had needed, when we had what we needed. We repent tonight for not understanding your majesty and not understanding how great you are. For making you small in our eye. If you hear me tonight, take a step. We repent of that tonight. Because we've made you small when you're so big. When you're so great. I feel like my words can't do him justice. I feel like I'm up here trying to do him justice, and there's no way that I can describe him. And I'm trying to describe him. But how can you describe greatness? How can you describe perfection? How can you describe God? To say he's good? That ain't good enough. To say he's good, good, good? That ain't good enough. To say he's perfect? That is not even enough. How do you ascribe greatness to greatness? How? What can you ascribe to God? How can you describe him? Raise your hand. How can I describe you? Hand raise. Jump, ask yourself in your mind, where you in your little small mind, how can you describe him? In your brain, how can you magnify him? How can you tell someone how wonderful and how merciful he is? How can I describe you, Jesus? My description will never be enough. That's right, Miss Carolyn. My description will never be enough. It'll never be adequate. I can't describe you. That's a song. I'm hearing a song, somebody in the room. How can I describe you? Let's get ready to prepare our hearts to sow our best to the King. Everybody get an envelope. If you have a question while the envelopes, I saw my brother had his hands raised. Somebody give him a mic. To keep Pastor Elliot, Takeda, get that young man a mic. He had his hands raised. I didn't mean to do all this tonight. Somebody pulled this out of me. Somebody came here tonight for a word and they got it. Give him a mic. If you have a question while the offering, everybody get an envelope. Somebody came here for a word. Just give him a mic. He had a question. If you got a question, you could come. Give him a mic. Take him a mic. Give it to the key. Give it to the key first. She came.
So I just wanted to share how powerful this word was tonight. So I just want to encourage Dr. Hepburn, that was just such a timely word from the Lord tonight.
Thank you.
Glory be to God for that. So I just wanted to share this, how I was just sitting in my seat like boiling on fire when he was preaching. Yesterday I had saw a news clip through CNN. And when I watched this news clip, you know, those that know, I do fashion, I put on different fashion shows, and I have a joy in it, like planning and putting events together, and it's something I really, really love to do.
Hallelujah.
So this year, I have not done any events. During the year, I usually plan about 5 to 6 events on top of going to different events, but this year has just been on pause for me because of everything that's going on. So, yesterday I was actually, I'm actually in the process of planning my next event for January, process of putting everything together. So I was watching on CNN, it was a lady, she was 55 years old. I don't know if you read the clip that I had sent you.
I saw it, but I didn't get
to
read it.
So I sent Dr. Hepburn a clip. It was a lady, she was 55 years old. This lady had her own boutique, and during the COVID-19, when it hit, she got so discouraged. This all boils down to the principles of what Dr. Hepburn was teaching, because the principles work for those who work the principles.
Come on.
Amen. So she got really discouraged, and she said she heard something just came inside of her, an idea, which she didn't know that was the Holy Spirit, because this lady wasn't saved. She just said she felt an urgency. She felt an idea,
an unction
in her to start putting on these online fashion shows.
Wow, come on, Takiya.
So when she put these online fashion shows, she said, I always had a desire to model, you know, since I was younger. I always wanted to model and just be a model, but I was afraid to be a model at 55. She said, I was afraid.
At 55.
She said, I was afraid to be a model at 55.
Wow.
She said,
age does not matter. That's what I said to her.
Yes. So the Holy Spirit was just putting this in my spirit to share this. So she was 55 years old. She said she always had a desire to model and put together these fashion shows, but the pressure of COVID-19 gave her this idea to start putting together these
The pressure of COVID-19. This is my sermon.
She said the pressure of COVID-19 she had an idea to start putting online fashion
shows together
because her clothes were not selling, because it was considered a non-essential business. So you all know that clothing is considered non-essential, so business had to close.
Come on.
So she went on Facebook, she took her clothes, she got a group of ladies, five ladies.
Grace and favor.
Five ladies, and she
talked. She's 55 and got five ladies.
Yes,
wow.
And she
began.
She began to show them the gift that was inside of her that she always wanted to do. She started to like create different like modeling techniques. This was coming out of her.
Wow.
And she started creating different modeling techniques, and she started to teach the older ladies the modeling techniques. Lo and behold, this lady went on Facebook. She didn't have a runway. She took a regular red carpet that she got from Amazon. carpet and put it in the middle of her house and began to create her own runway.
Wow.
She began to put these fashion shows on social media. She just blew up.
Wow.
She blew up on
social media. Are you all hearing this? This is powerful stuff.
She blew up on social media. So she said, when you was talking about how God doesn't stop unless we stop.
Oh.
So she began to get more creative and start saying, I'm going to create a fashion show in my own living room.
Wow.
And these fashion shows began to get viral.
Wow.
Her clothes were selling in the mix of
this is my message.
COVID-19.
When you send this to me today.
Yesterday.
I sent you the article yesterday.
My
God, go.
So she just started getting like real creative, and she said all these creative. So she said the very thing she wanted to do lived.
Wow. It was inside of her.
It was inside of her. Her wealth and what she had inside of her to create these fashion shows.
That's
and
powerful.
Now her clothing is selling all over the world. And she's on CNN. So this lady has went global.
CNN?
Yes, this lady has went global because of just one idea. She had the oil that was in her house.
That was in her house. So good.
Amen. So
good.
I just wanted to share that because I believe that was meant to encourage the body today to not give up on your dreams. Don't give up on what God has placed inside of you,
powerful.
No matter what the situation is.
Powerful.
Create, build.
And I even said the law is not bound to Christians.
Yes, that's exactly. So I was like so in agreement with you.
That I said.
So in agreement with you tonight when you was preaching that message, because it was just so powerful.
Wow.
So I just wanted to share
Everybody in church need to read the article.
Yes,
Shadrach, you need to get that article on the screen.
Yes.
Give that to Shadrach to put on the screen. Give that mic to that young man. The young man right there. He had a question. Give it to the young. Go right down the aisle. You're going the right way. Straight down the middle. The middle. Right there on the side of his wife in the green. He had a question. You could stay right there with the mic. So powerful, Takiya. I'm so glad you shared that.
To God be the glory. I was just going to say, you know, I learned over the time of living that what you were saying, you know, in the midst of everything and our tragedies, we don't believe nothing. You know what I mean? Or we believe something, but it don't be God.
That's right.
And God allowed me to get this vision in this sermon. And he told me in a short, brief quote, he said, God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves.
Wow.
And that's all I wanted
to say. I like that. Y'all heard that? I like that.
God be the glory.
God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves. Come on, y'all, clap your hands for that. I like that. I like that. Takia, the young lady in the back, have a question in the back, in the mask. So good. I like that. God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves. I love that. I love that. I love that. I love that.
I just want to say thank you for this ceremony, because last night I was talking to somebody that hurt me in the past, but by the grace of God, he allowed that person to apologize and
wow.
for me to forgive.
Yes.
And then we got into like a really deep conversation, and then I asked him what was so wrong with me that made you hurt me because I hurt you, and we just kept kind of going tick for tack. And then today you said it ain't about what it was that hurt you. It's what was inside of you that needed to be brought out against that pain.
Oh,
so
today.
Just, yeah. like everything you said today, it's so many bits and pieces of what you said today is what we talked about last night. It's so crazy.
That's
and I was
God.
Telling him
That's
it's
God.
The little stuff inside you that he needed to take out of you
yes.
during the pain of the entire thing. So Amen. It's not we get so caught up in the hurt. We get so caught up in the sorrow. We
yes,
don't even
yes.
recognize all this, the strength that he's given us.
Amen.
So I legit thank you because it's a confirmation of me. That he hears me.
Yes, he is hearing
it,
yes.
It's him telling me. It's, you know, it's so many people in the world. They like, oh, God ain't real. How you confused? It's something wrong with you because you believe. Why? What brought you to this point that you have to believe in God? And it's like, how is it how you don't believe?
That's
like,
right.
He's how is he? Nobody know what I'm going through.
That's right.
But how is it that what everybody's talking about is what I... you know, what I'm saying and
That's
what
right.
I'm going through.
Uh-huh.
So I just really, ever since I've been coming here, I feel like I went from an infant to a toddler because
Hallelujah.
Now I'm learning.
Come on,
how
clap your hands, y'all. That's awesome. Testify, girl. Let's stand. Amen. Son, in the home in a few minutes, he's so uncomfortable over there, y'all. He's fighting it so hard over there. Yo, clap your hands for him. Clap your hands for him. He's fighting. His body's tough. He's fighting to be here. Punch your hands. He's fighting. Chris, you make sure you help him to the car. He's fighting. Chris, come on the side. Help him about his seat. Really, you could take the camera. Just help him. He's fighting. Body going through. That's a real surgery, y'all. He had a real surgery, real pain. No joke. So don't let him be in dress up over there. Show his real pain. He was really taking real pills, real pain. Let's pray that this recovery be speedily. Amen. He's just trying to be so comfortable over there. He's so uncomfortable. Point your hands at your seat. Come on, Jacob. Point like the millions coming. Somebody say, I will be debt free. Say, I will owe no man nothing except to love him. Father, tonight, God, as every hand's pointed, yes, God, Lashawn, the Father, let our monies and our finances overflow. God, give us another perspective. When we leave here tonight, God, help us to really hear. Not just a good sermon, not just another word, but help us to get it. That through our tragedy, you're trying to bring faith. It's in these times that our faith must rise. In the worst of times, you're trying to bring the best of times. In the midst of Rona, you're trying to show your power. In the midst of hate, you're trying to show your love. Oh, come on, point your hands, y'all. He's really trying to shine. But it's all our perspective. Father, everyone that's sowed tonight, honor. Somebody say this to me and say, God, you have not forsaken me. If you believe that, take a step. Say, God, you will never forsake me. If you mean that, take another step. If you mean that, say, God, you have not forsaken me. If you mean that, take another step. Say, God, you will never forsake me. Do you know his words that I'll never leave you nor forsake you? That word is for somebody in this room tonight. He said, I'll never leave you. That's a promise. That's a promise. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Say, thank you, Jesus. Both hands raised. Father, tonight, as we go, I declare and decree a hedge of protection. Father, let your Holy Spirit guide us. Keep us safe on the highways. Lord, Abaku Shatarabaka Satara, we rebuke untimely death. Every word curse, every spirit of poverty, lack, disease, we plead the blood of Jesus. Let this offering be a sweet smell. Honor every gift. Father, bless the food. Is there food in the back here? Bless the food, God. Bless the hands that are prepared. God, tonight, keep Quinn. Quinn had surgery, a little minor surgery. Y'all keep her covered. I don't know where Daryl is tonight. Keep him covered. Anyone that you don't see tonight, call by name. Call their name. Say it in your spirit out. Say it out. Say it out of your mouth. Father, wherever they are, we cover them tonight. Watch over them. Protect them. Andy, Tiffany. Thank you for the faithfulness. Pastor Cocroft, Natalie. Mother Diana, God. Even names I haven't called. Stacy. Stacy Rios. Stacy Yogita Mohan. We cover under the blood. Toya Plummer. Somebody say, in the name of Jesus. Tisha JB. If I don't call your name, don't get mad. God knows your name. Somebody say, God knows my name. But we cover you now and you are blessed. Somebody say, I am blessed. Say it and mean it. Say, I am blessed. Chris, help him. Don't let him tell you that he don't need your help. Be gentle with him. Help him like you'd want somebody to help you. Don't let, you know, sometimes Jonathan, you know Jonathan, don't let him fool you. He's trying to be tough and strong. He's hurting. Help him.